In the last movie, you learned how to use and set up the Arnold Renderer with basic 3ds Max functionality. In the process, you learned that Arnold is compatible with 3ds Max's physical materials, physical cameras, and photometric lights. If you have used photometric lights in the past and are comfortable with them, then you may continue to use them with Arnold. Still, you may also want to look at Arnold's own light type, as you may find it more convenient to work with. Continue with the scene you worked on in the last movie. You can also use the scene named diningsetlights.max if you need to catch up. This scene is currently lit by 6 photometric lights that were created and saved in a previous release of 3ds Max. Select these lights and delete them. You'll light the scene using Arnold lights only. Arnold lights are easy to use and even easier to find. There's a category for Arnold lights in the Create Lights panel, with only one entry to avoid confusion. Different light types for different scenarios can then be selected from a drop-down list. The default is a quad light, but you also have options for other familiar types such as point and spotlights. Let's stick with the quad light for now. In the top view, click the center of the scene to place a light. A quad light is placed at floor level. You can move it up in a side view. The camera view shading gets overexposed. Simply set the shading mode to standard. Take a look at the new light in both the top view and in the modify panel. By default, it is set to a 2:4 aspect ratio, much like a fluorescent box. A little lower, there are intensity parameters you can adjust. Do test render of the camera view first, you'll find it's rather dark. You can boost the intensity of the light in a couple of ways. You can change the intensity value itself, or you can change the exposure value, which essentially acts like an intensity multiplier. By increasing the exposure value by one notch, you in fact double the resulting intensity value. Set it to 14 and try another render. The scene should look better, although still far from perfect. It's missing some global illumination effects, and the shadow quality is below par. We'll investigate these issues momentarily. In doing so, we'll be jumping back and forth between the Modify panel and the Render Settings dialog, so make sure you can see both. Make sure the quad light is still selected. Below the intensity group in the Modify panel, you'll notice a rendering section, and in particular a samples parameter value. The concept of samples often comes back with Arnold, and you see it in lights, materials, and global render settings. Typically, the higher the value and the more quality you end up with. As far as lights are concerned, more samples help reduce noise artifacts in the shadow areas, as confirmed by the tooltip. Set the samples value to 5 and try again. You should get a better result than earlier. It's a bit dark below the table, as if not enough light is getting underneath. Take a look at the Render Settings dialog in the Arnold Renderer tab. In the General section, there are many values you can adjust for better rendering results. You also have separate sampling controls for diffuse, reflections, transparency values, among others. You can also adjust ray depth values, which are essentially ray bounce factors. Increase the diffuse ray depth value to 4 and render again. The table and chair legs should be easier to see. The shadows may also feel a bit soft. This is the direct result of the size of the light. In the Modify panel, bring the light size down to 1 foot by 1 foot and try again. This should result in sharper shadows. Copy the light and set the copy to illuminate the scene from the left. You may consider bringing down the exposure value a notch to 13 and render again. Copy the light one more time to create a fill light from the right. Bring down the exposure value another notch or two on that fill light. Take a look at your last render, right underneath the table. You can zoom in on the rendered window using the mouse wheel. There's still a fair amount of noise down there. Let's see what we can do to improve that. This can be improved by increasing the diffuse sampling of the rendering engine. As always, keep in mind that this usually comes at the price of making rendering calculations more time-consuming. There are separate values to increase sampling quality for diffuse, reflections, transparency, subsurface scattering, etc. You want to set values that work best with the project at hand, by increasing values that make a difference, and decreasing those you don't need. If a scene does not use subsurface scattering, for example, then there's no point increasing the quality at that level. You'd only be making rendering times longer. In this case, increasing the diffuse sampling value will help tune down the shadow noise. Note the number 36 that derives from the value currently set at 2. To avoid confusion and keep this tutorial from being too technical, I will not dwell on the math behind these values. Suffice to say that increasing the sampling improves the image quality, but adds to the render time. In this case, a default diffuse sampling of 2 is resulting in a render that takes less than half a minute to compute on this machine, but yields significant noise in the shadows. A diffuse sample value of 6 will show significant improvement in quality, but the rendering time has doubled. The camera anti-aliasing AA samples value is quite important as it acts as a multiplier for all other values. Note what happens to the diffuse resulting rays of 324 when you take up the camera AA value one notch from 3 to 4. The resulting diffuse rays have gone up from 324 to 576. Raising the camera AA value to 6 increases the resulting diffuse rays to 1296. All other sampling values are also multiplied when the camera AA value is changed. Of course, this means that rendering time can increase exponentially, in this case going over 3 minutes from under a minute a moment ago. So you can think of the camera anti-aliasing value as a global multiplier for image quality, whereas the other values are more specific. A good practice suggests to set the diffuse, specular, transmission, subsurface scattering values to the proportions that a scene or project needs. Then use the camera AA global multiplier to switch from fast renders, small AA values, to final renders, high AA values. You can even set the camera AA to a negative value for a very quick but ugly render. Finally, the preview AA control is useful because, as the name implies, it provides you with a quick feedback in the form of a progressive render. It is useful because you can easily see if you are on the right track or if you need to cancel the render and work further on your project. Once you are comfortable with what the scene should look like, you can always turn that option off. This will skip the progressive first pass render and go straight to the full render as set by other parameters. In the next movie, you take what you have learned so far and apply that knowledge to a more contextual scenario. You'll be using Arnold to render an interior scene.